From the Cronkite Studios in downtown Phoenix, this is Cronkite News.
The coronavirus spreads to Arizona. What this means for you and your family and how to better protect yourself.
Plus, several efforts are underway to legalize marijuana in Arizona. We'll tell you what they are and their possible impact.
And the Arizona GOP on a mission to keep Arizona red as we near the November election.
Cronkite News starts now.
Good evening and welcome to Cronkite News on Arizona PBS. I'm Stephanie Rodriguez.
And I'm Sean Rice. Thank you for joining us. News that a Tempe resident has contracted coronavirus is raising concerns. Health officials say the patient is connected to Arizona State University, but it's not known whether they're a male or female or a student or employee.
Cronkite News reporter Isabella Holsizer visited ASU's Tempe campus and found some taking extra precautions to avoid getting sick. Isabella?
University officials note the Tempe patient is not severely ill and is in isolation to keep the illness from spreading. But people are still worried. ASU students petitioned unsuccessfully to get classes canceled, and some local stores report running out of hand sanitizer and masks.
A lot of kids, students, and faculty and staff are wearing more masks because of the alert that they sent out.
That alert went out Sunday, announcing the first confirmed case of coronavirus in Arizona and the fifth so far in the U.S. In all five cases, the patients had traveled to Wuhan, China, the epicenter of the outbreak. Federal health officials note there have been no person-to-person spread detected here in the U.S., but Arizona residents are still being careful.
Some classmates of mine have avoided classes or have gone to classes like wearing gloves or wearing like a mask because they're afraid of the virus to get contaminated and like to not be able to continue their education.
Despite all the worries, experts say the likelihood of contracting the virus is not as great as getting sick with something more common.
Much more likely this time of year and with everything going on in our community is influenza, which we're having a really big year. Arizona, we're up to close to 1,000 cases, which is about three times what we usually have by this time in the year. So, you know, I would really say be vigilant for fever and cough anytime. Seek medical attention, but understand that it's much more likely to be one of our routine respiratory problems like influenza rather than a coronavirus.
Public officials recommend following basic prevention guidelines to avoid contracting any respiratory disease. Live in the broadcast center, Isabella Holsizer, Cronkite News.
There's been a lot of conflicting information shared about the coronavirus, so we wanted to sort some fact from fiction. First, there's no vaccine for the virus, despite the rumors, so we're putting that in the fiction column. There's another claim that the virus was made in a lab, which also led to rumors of a patent. This is also false, according to factcheck.org. The cause is still being investigated. Washing your hands frequently and maintaining good hygiene is actually the best way to protect yourself, according to the CDC. The CDC also recommends avoiding non-essential travel to China in order to limit the spread of the disease. While the flu shot doesn't protect against the coronavirus, the CDC still recommends getting one because we're in peak flu season. For continuing coverage of the coronavirus, follow us on Facebook and Twitter and find us online at cronkitenews.azpbs.org.
The 2020 legislative session has begun, and two Democratic representatives have proposed legalizing adult use of marijuana. Representatives Randall Fries and Isela Blanc are hoping the legalization will cut down on arrest and other problems. Delaney White explains how.
I spoke with cannabis advocates at the Capitol who are pushing for legalization. They say it would improve the lives of everyone in the community.
Neuropathy and for service-connected PTSD.
U.S. veteran Timothy Pena says he uses marijuana to cope with post-traumatic stress disorder.
Timothy was arrested in 2014 for possession of marijuana. It was his first time offense, and he was sentenced to 2 years in Arizona Department of Corrections. Pena did not possess a medical card at that time. He says he couldn't afford one. If the current bills that have been introduced to the legislature become law, they would decrease the number of arrests and promote successful treatment and recovery outcomes.
This is the reality. It's here. It's not going anywhere. So it's time for modern minds to melt and get around this and pass this for the safety, these bills for the safety of the citizens and for the needs of the health that cannabis provides.
Michael Weiser, the executive director of the Arizona State Chapter of the National Organization for the Reform of Marijuana Laws, is working to reform marijuana policy and advocacy for cannabis consumers.
We're hoping that if Representative Blackmun's bill, police deflection bill, does pass, that it will reduce the number of people who get arrested in Arizona for cannabis. It's based on a program out of Tucson, and we'd like to see it rolled out statewide.
If passed, Arizona House Bill 2638 will cut down on the number of arrests for people who are in a situation similar to Timothy's. But passing these bills will not come without challenges.
There's a stigma with cannabis, with marijuana, right? There's a stigma that deals just because of what it is, right, and what it has been. So with that stigma comes the ability to talk to people to make them understand what it is and what it isn't.
Legalization of marijuana, especially for veterans, is one. Marijuana is the only substance that I have found that has a direct effect on my PTSD. It is the only substance that I can take, whether it's alcohol or opioids or whatever, marijuana is the only thing that keeps my PTSD in check.
Voters may also be able to weigh in on the issue. The Smart and Safe Act is an initiative that would legalize the sale, possession, and consumption of 1 ounce of marijuana for adults at least 21 years old. The Smart and Safe Act is likely to meet the requirements to be on the November 2020 ballot. Live in the Broadcast Center, Delaney White, Cronkite News.
A federal court has found Arizona's policy of discarding voter ballots if turned in at the wrong precinct violates the law. A court of appeals judge says the practice has a discriminatory effect on American, Indian, Hispanic, and African American voters in the state. Republicans who backed the law argued it was a common sense way to prevent fraud. The court also ruled a 2016 Arizona law barring people from returning early ballots for someone else violates the Voting Rights Act and the Constitution.
November's election day may seem far away, but Arizona Republicans are already focused on keeping the state red.
Cronkite News reporter Danielle Malkin stopped in at the Arizona GOP State Committee meeting to hear exactly what the party members are doing to keep Republicans in Washington.
Hallie Overman-Jackman has been selling political memorabilia and merchandise for 2 years. Customers kept her busy at the annual GOP State Committee meeting in Phoenix. The vendor says this is her way to support Arizona's Republican candidates.
Actually, it's to help raise money for the candidates, and that's what we're doing today. It's just part of the process. You have to get the word out so people know what's going on.
Saturday's meeting brought together GOP members from across the state to discuss party business and prepare for an election year. Chairwoman Kelly Ward says the party's population is growing within the state, home to over 1.3 million registered Republicans. That number is up from January of 2018, but so are the number of registered Democrats and independents. Ward's goal for her party? Keep Arizona red.
Well, because Republican principles and Republican policies are what move the country in the right direction. No matter where they're implemented, all over the world, people are healthier, they're more secure, they're safer, they're more prosperous, and they're happier. And so we've got to get Republicans in office so those Republican policies can be put into action.
Also in attendance, Governor Doug Ducey.
Our state has never been stronger. Our economy has never been better.
And from Capitol Hill, Arizona's GOP congressional delegation. There was no shortage of impeachment discussion.
This is a total sham. They're full of BS.
Arizona's congressional members criticized House Democrats in their impeachment trial against President Donald Trump.
God we trust. He gave us a man by the name of Donald Trump.
Sharing their thoughts on the impeachment trial and its effects on Americans.
It's the Schumer Schiff sham. And all I see is how they have misused the Constitution. These are the same people that blasted the Constitution that was actually built by old white racist guys. And now they're quoting it. They're not actually quoting it, they're misquoting it. This is a fishing expedition that is horrible, absolutely horrible. people will pay the price for what they've done here.
The public either has completely tuned out, already has their mind made up, or they've also sort of stepped into how much of this has now become sort of satiation of political rage.
As for Jackman, she believes Americans need to stand behind the president, regardless of party, in order to reunite a divided nation.
You know, we've gone through this with Obama. We went through it, of course, with Clinton. It seems to be the new norm, and that's unfortunate. We need to stand behind our president. When Obama was in there, you never heard me open my mouth, but try and support him as much as possible. We need to bring America back together.
In Phoenix, Danielle Malkin, Cronkite News.
Coming up next, President Donald Trump makes history, speaking at the March for Life rally.
And Cronkite News was there. When we come back, what Arizonians who traveled to the event in Washington had to say.
And protesters around the world voicing their concerns on military action in the Middle East.
By the year 2050, there will be more plastic in the ocean than fish. Before Professor Halden, I had an insane amount of passion, but I almost felt helpless because I didn't know how to use it. Professor Halden gave me a chance to make a difference. Being at a place like ASU allows you to take these big leaps. Ultimately, the biggest problems in the world cannot be solved alone.
As journalists at Cronkite News, we report on stories that matter to you by focusing on the local impact. We dig deeper and work tirelessly to keep you informed.
Live in Wickerburg.
Live in Los Angeles.
In Cleveland.
In Washington.
In Louisville.
From Jerusalem.
Live in Philadelphia.
From around the world to right here in Phoenix.
At Cronkite News, we report the facts and stick to the truth.
It's been going on for nearly a half century, anti-abortion groups descending on Washington every January to protest Supreme Court's Roe v. Wade ruling that recognized a woman's right to an abortion. But this year, marchers say things are looking up for their cause, as Cronkite News reporter Gabrielle Collage reports from our Washington Bureau.
They came from all over the country, but the thousands at the 47th annual March for Life had the same goal as always, overturning the 1973 Supreme Court decision that legalized abortion across the U.S.
Garrett Riley, executive director of the Arizona Life Coalition, feels this year is different.
This is the largest March for Life in 47 years, and I think what's important is by this march growing, and these kinds of marches and rallies growing, like the one we had in Arizona last week, also growing, it's a sign, it's evidence that the pro-life movement is winning over the hearts of people.
Another sign was the presence of President Donald Trump, the first president ever to appear in person at the rally.
The tens of thousands of Americans gathered today not only stand for life, it's really here that they stand for it so proudly together, and I want to thank everybody for that.
A bunch of protesters at the march declined to talk to us, but NARAL Pro-Choice America President Elise Hogue called Trump's appearance, quote, an act of desperation, end quote, by a president facing impeachment. Tempe resident Katie Forbes was excited to be at the march and excited to see the president, but she had a more personal reason for being there, an unplanned pregnancy while she was a junior in college.
I wasn't living for myself anymore. I had to fight for him because if I wasn't going to stand up for him as his mother, nobody was going to. And I fought for him, and I want to fight for other unborn children.
That fight led her here. But she said the debate over abortion doesn't need to be the heated fight that it often is.
I would tell someone who's not sure where they stand, if they're pro-life or if they're pro-choice, to look at the facts, to look at medical research, to read people's stories, to hear their stories, to listen to women who have had unplanned pregnancies, listen to women who have had abortions, hear both sides of the story.
In Washington, Gabrielle Collage, Cronkite News.
Pro-life groups had more to cheer about than just the presence of the president. This year, the Supreme Court is scheduled to take up a case in March dealing with a Louisiana law restricting abortions in that state. It's a case that would be considered by a court that has two new conservative justices appointed by Trump.
The U.S. Supreme Court has lifted an order blocking a change concerning benefits for immigrants. A New York judge tried to put a stop to the proposed rule that would make it harder for low-income immigrants to become legal. The Trump administration's rule would allow people applying for a green card or visa to be judged on income and education levels, and if they use public assistance like food stamps. But opponents worry it would not stop immigrants from participating in government programs that could help struggling families. The Supreme Court was just asked to lift that initial halt, and they ruled to allow it to take effect.
Congress may be consumed with impeachment right now, but protesters gathered in Tucson, Washington, and cities all around the world this weekend to remind lawmakers they have another job.
Cronkite News reporter Kara Harris has a story from our Washington Bureau.
This was the scene outside of the White House Saturday for one of the rallies as part of the International Day of Action, No War on Iran.
We came out here to, as U.S. people, to say, U.S. troops out of Iraq, no more war, no more imperialism, and also no new war on Iran.
Cook volunteers for the Answer Coalition, an anti-war organization. She says going to war doesn't answer the needs of everyday Americans.
This is really has a material effect on our daily lives. The greater the war budget, the less money we see going to our basic services.
For Washington resident Allison Saj, the conflict with Iran has already had a real impact.
Actually, I had a niece that was killed on the plane that was shot down after the attack. And so we just don't want anybody losing their kids or their family.
Daniel Kingery, a former Arizona resident, said the U.S. strike on Soleimani was an abuse of governmental checks and balances.
Our government does not have the power to do an offensive strike of any kind of a war. The declaration prohibits that.
Protesters hold the Trump administration accountable for current escalated tensions in Iran, but they do admit there's blame on both sides of the aisle.
Should be very clear on it's not just a Trump policy, but the U.S. has been at war on a war footing and pushing toward war and intervention in the Middle East for the past almost 30 years.
According to the latest Reuters poll, over 71% of Americans believe that the U.S. will be at war with Iran in coming years. Cook sees little sign of otherwise.
Both the Republicans and the Democrats, year after year, pass these massive trillion-dollar war budgets, and so we would just say end of war, no occupation, no interventions.
But Saj remains hopeful that the country will not go to war.
I like to think America stands for democracy and freedom and not a war machine that makes money.
After the break, an Arizona man facing jail time for feeding cats.
Why cops are cracking down on feeding feral felines. Plus, your chance to weigh in on the cat controversy.
Phoenix is just beautiful today. Let's take a look at the weather around the valley.
Thank you for joining us for the special edition of Cronkite News.
Here are the top stories that we're tracking today at noon.
Some of the best players for their program.
Right now, a Gilbert man is facing possible jail time for feeding feral cats.
According to ABC 15, 64-year-old Paul Rodriguez has spent the last 14 years giving strays food and water with his own time and money. But in 2018, the town of Gilbert passed an ordinance banning any feeding of feral cats on town property.
Now that didn't stop him, and eventually he was arrested. So we want to know what you think about this. Should the feeding of feral or wild animals be illegal? Yes, it's unsanitary, or no, it's unclear.
Right now, about 70% of you say it should not be illegal. It's not too late to join the conversation. Just go to our Cronkite News Twitter feed to vote in our live interactive poll.
Right now, we're going to send it to weather with Stephanie Bates. Stephanie, it seems like we got some pretty clear skies out there today.
Yeah, you know what? Not many folks around the country are lucky enough to say they are feeling temperatures as cool as we are in the last week of January. We actually got as warm as 70 degrees today. Let me go ahead and show you what I'm talking about. The sun will set at 5:56 p.m., and those temperatures are going to fall right with it. We're going to be in those mid-60s by 7 p.m., trailing off into the high 50s by 9 and 10 o'clock this evening with clear skies throughout the night. Now, waking up tomorrow, the sun will rise at 7:30 a.m., and if you're headed out to the Pro-Am at TPC Scottsdale, it's going to be pretty chilly. We've got clouds throughout the day, barely breaking 60 degrees by noon, so you're definitely going to want to bring a jacket. As we centralize in on the valley for tomorrow, we are all going to be below average for this time of year, only topping out at 66 degrees here in Phoenix, as well as in Levine and Surprise. Cave Creek will be our cool spot in the valley tomorrow, topping out at 62 degrees. Now, as we look ahead at the next 3 days, we've got a 10% chance of showers tomorrow. We've got low temperatures heading into Thursday and Friday. And if you're headed out to the Waste Management Phoenix Open this weekend, those skies are going to clear out with nothing but sunshine. Highs are going to be in the mid-70s. We're going to kick off our work week with a 20% chance of showers on Monday. Temperatures are going to be well below average. I'm Stephanie Bates in the Cronkite Weather Center.
The world continues to remember basketball legend Kobe Bryant, who was killed in a helicopter crash over the weekend.
When we come back, we'll take a look at the lasting impact Bryant had on the sport and its players.
By the year 2050, there will be more plastic in the ocean than fish. Before Professor Halden, I had an insane amount of passion, but I almost felt helpless because I didn't know how to use it. Professor Halden gave me a chance to make a difference. Being at a place like ASU allows you to take these big leaps. Ultimately, the biggest problems in the world cannot be solved alone.
As journalists at Cronkite News, we report on stories that matter to you by focusing on the local impact. We dig deeper and work tirelessly to keep you informed.
Live in Wickerburg.
Live in Los Angeles.
In Cleveland.
In Washington.
In Louisville.
From Jerusalem.
Live in Philadelphia.
From around the world to right here in Phoenix.
At Cronkite News, we report the facts and stick to the truth.
The sports world continues to mourn the loss of one of the greatest basketball players to ever set foot on a court, Kobe Bryant. Rob Werner has more on the impact the Laker great had on the women's game.
Kobe Bryant was absolutely outspoken in his support of women's basketball and the stage he thought it deserved. Yesterday, members of the women's basketball community, including ASU players and Sun Devils head coach Charlie Turner Thorne, shared their thoughts on what Bryant meant to the women's game.
It's interesting when really, really powerful people, or really, really successful people, or really, really talented people have daughters. You know, because a lot of times, clearly, you know, sports is dominated by men, you know, and so, and, you know, we are obviously very grateful for all the coverage that we get and, you know, the things that we have, but it's not, no work in comparison. So when somebody like that, you know, recognizes and has an appreciation for the women's game, it's amazing.
He was just a big impact to not only basketball, but just the world in general. And a lot of kids looked up to him growing up. I know I played basketball and I looked up to him when I was younger. I mean, I bought his shoes maybe every 2 weeks. I bought a new pair of his shoes and I just loved him.
I had just shown an interview of Kobe Bryant, a short interview to my team last week, going into last week's game. It was an awesome interview about how he talked, you know, he was asked, you know, are you more fear of failure or, you know, will to win? And he said, I'm neither. He said, I don't, you know, either one of those is not going to help you, you know, perform. I'm about just figuring things out. I'm about being in the moment.
Less than a year ago in May, the Laker legend brought his 13-year-old daughter Gianna's AAU team to visit the Phoenix Mercury. The WNBA community continues to grieve the loss of the icon and his daughter Gigi.
Oh, really?
He didn't fake anything. He wasn't one
to say things that he didn't mean. He wasn't one to do things that he didn't believe in. And, you know, he had a different perspective.
You know, at 41, he had so much life to live. He was just starting his life in a lot of ways. We know him as the basketball player, absolutely, but I think even that small amount of time where he was retired, you could see he had a lot to give.
Bryant played for the Lakers for 20 seasons with a superstar constantly showing support to women's players in college like Oregon's Sabrina Ionescu and professionals such as the Mercury's Diana Taurasi. Just last week, Bryant said several WNBA players, including Taurasi, could play in the NBA today. And while he is now gone, his actions will continue to inspire players for many more years to come. In the Broadcast Center, Rob Werner, Cronkite News.
Cronkite News is proud to be the news division of Arizona PBS. Here's what's coming up on Arizona Horizon and PBS NewsHour.
Tuesday on Arizona Horizon, we'll talk about the economic impact of Arizona hospitals, which is in the billions, and hear from a Yale professor who's written a book on creating a better earth. That's Tuesday on Arizona Horizon.
I'm Judy Woodruff. Tonight on the NewsHour, President Trump's lawyers take the Senate floor as new details emerge over what his former national security advisor, John Bolton, knew. Coming up after Cronkite News in Arizona Horizon.
That's it for Cronkite News tonight. Thanks for joining us.
For top Arizona stories anytime, go to cronkitenews.azpbs.org.